Hello students, you are going to write your periodic test 2, right? Hope you are all preparing well for periodic test 2. Now we will revise for our periodic test 2. Overall, you will be writing your periodic test 2 for 50 marks. This is your question paper pattern. Section A, Roman letter 1, reading comprehension. One passage they will given in the question paper. Below that, you have 5 questions. First, you have to read the passage carefully. Then, understand the passage. Next, you have to read the questions and answer the questions from the given passage. In reading comprehension, you will get 5 questions. In that, each question carries 1 mark, so totally 5 marks for reading comprehension. Section B, Writing Skills, Roman letter 2, make notes of the following passage. So, for note making, you will get 5 marks. Next one is, identify and correct the errors in the following sentences. In spotting errors, you will get 5 questions. Each question carries 1 mark, so totally 5 marks for spotting errors. Next one is letter writing. In letter writing, they will ask one informal letter. For that, you will get 5 marks. Section C, Grammar, Roman letter 3, pick out the correct homophone. Here, you have to pick out the correct homophone. They have given in a fill-up format. First, read the sentence and inside the bracket, they will give you the 2 words which has the different meaning, different spelling, but as similar sound. According to the given sentence, you have to choose any one of the correct word. In homophones, you will get 2 questions. Each question carries 1 mark, so totally 2 marks for homophones. Next one is, frame 2 sentences for each of the given homonyms. Here, they will give you 2 homonyms. For each homonym, you have to write 2 sentences. In homonyms, you will get 2 questions. Each question carries 1 mark. So, totally 2 marks for homonyms. Next one is, punctuate the following sentences. So for punctuations, you will get 3 questions. Each question carries 1 mark. So totally 3 marks for punctuations. Next one is, identify whether the underlined word is a common, proper, abstract or collective noun. Here, you will get 2 questions. Each question carries 1 mark. So, totally 2 marks. Next one is, identify the adjectives in the following sentences and state their kind. Here also, you will get 2 questions. Each question carries 1 mark. So, totally 2 marks. Next one is, recognize the underlined pronoun. Here also you will get 2 questions. Each question carries 1 mark. So totally 2 marks for pronouns. Next one is, fill in the blanks with suitable tense form. Here you will get 6 questions. Each question carries 1 mark. So, totally 6 marks for tenses. Section D, Literature, Roman letter 4, synonyms. Here, they will give you 2 synonyms. Each carries 1 mark. So, overall, 2 marks for synonyms. Next one is antonyms. Here, they will give you 2 antonyms. Each carries 1 mark. So, overall, 2 marks for antonyms. Next one is answer the following briefly. Here, they will give you 2 questions. Each question carries 2 marks. So, totally 4 marks for answer the following briefly. What are all the questions given in your book bag? Thorough with that. Concentrate only in the short answers. Next one is identify the alliteration in the given lines. Here, they will give you 2 lines. In that, you have to identify alliterated words. For alliteration, you will get 1 mark. Next one is identify the rhyme scheme in the given lines. Here, they will give you 4 lines from the poem. In that, you have to identify the rhyme scheme. For rhyme scheme, you will get 2 marks. First, we are going to revise homophone. Homophone is made of 2 words, homo plus phone. Homo means same, phone means sound. Combining them, it becomes words having same sound. So what is mean by homophones? Words which have the same pronunciation but different spelling and different meanings. Next, we have weak, weak. The word weak means being unwell or without strength. The other word weak means word for the 7 days together. Next, we have sun, sun. The word son means child of a parent. The other word sun means sun is the light body that lights up the earth. See, see. Hair, hair. Now, let's see some more examples for homophones with example sentences. First, we have write, write. I like to write letters to my mom. Turn right on Elm Street. Next, we have deer, deer. The deer jumped over a log. She is my dear friend. Next, we have blue, blue. She blew the flower petals in the wind. Blue is my favorite color. Next, we have night, night. I like to look at the moon at night. The night is very brave. Next, we have plain, plain. It was a plain room. He went to Kashmir via plane. Next, we have peace, peace. Chavi's mind was in complete peace. After meditation, he gave me a small piece of cheese. Next, we are going to revise homonym. Homonym is made of 2 words, homo plus nym. Homo means same, nym means name. Combining them, it becomes words having same names. So, what is mean by homonyms? Words which have the same spelling and same pronunciation but different meanings. Next, we have left, left. The first left means direction to the left, while the second left means somebody has left the place. Next we have feet, feet. The first feet means two legs, while the second feet means measure used to calculate the length of something. Next we have pen, pen. Palm, palm. Then we have spring, spring. Next we have bat, bat. Now let's see some more examples for homonyms with example sentences. First we have bank. Bank is closed due to lockdown. I lived along the banks of the river. Then we have sink. The sink is in the kitchen. Coins sink in the water. Next we have ship. They travel by ship. We ship books out to New York every month. Then we have tie. Hope so, the game will tie among them. He always wears a shirt and tie. Next we have ring. He gifted me a ring. Please sit on the floor in a ring. Next we have spring. Flowers blow in spring weather. Springs are often made of coiled. Next we have saw. Handsaw is used for cut the wood. I saw her yesterday in market. Students, first we have to know what is mean by a punctuation. Punctuation is the system of symbols that we use to separate sentences and parts of sentences, and to make their meaning clear, each symbol is called a punctuation mark. First, we are going to see capital letters. First one is capitalize the first letter of the first word in a sentence. Examples are: we walked along the path to the lake. Did you bring the camera? Tie the boat to the dock. The water is freezing. Students, here we can see red color letters are capitalized. The second one is capitalize the pronoun I. Examples are: should I call you later? I think I will call at 6 o'clock. Louis and I shall both call you. Oops, I just remembered. I am grounded from the phone. Students, we always use a capital letter for festivals such as Diwali, Easter, Christmas, Eid, etc. We always use a capital letter for some historical periods such as the Middle Ages, the Industrial Revolution, and so on. Then we always use a capital letter for geographic regions such as Southern India, Northern Africa, the Middle East, etc. Then we always use a capital letter for titles of books or pieces of music like the Ruskin Bond Omnibus, Holst the Planets, and so on. Students, then we always use a capital letter for nationalities and words indicating the place a person or thing is from, such as Dutch, French, the Rocky Mountains, and so on. However, if we are referring to items that are part of a common expression or name of something found commonly, like Danish pastries, French toast, and so on, We do not use capital letters. Let's start with terminal punctuation. Terminal means the end. So, terminal punctuation marks are used to end sentences. These are period or full stop, exclamation mark, question mark. The period or full stop is used to mark the end of two types of sentences, declarative sentences and imperative sentences. Declarative sentences means sentences which give information. Examples are, I teach English. We had pizza for dinner last night. If it rains tomorrow, I will bring my umbrella. Then we are going to see imperative sentences. Imperative sentences means commands or request. Example sentences are, please don't feed the animals. Let me know what time your flight arrives. If it rains tomorrow, bring your umbrella. Next, let's see using exclamation marks to show anger. Example sentences, I hate you. To show joy. Example sentences, those flowers are so lovely. Then, to show surprise or excitement. Example sentences, I can't believe that you came first. Then, to ask for help. Example sentence, please help me. We also often use exclamation marks after one word or after a short word. Example sentences, oh, I am so disappointed, or wonderful, just what we needed. Next, we are going to see question mark. We use question mark to end a direct question. Question marks end all direct questions in English. Examples are, have you seen the film yet? What are you doing? What is this? Are you happy? Is this your house? Students, let's see when to use a hyphen. Using hyphens to form hyphenated words. Hyphenated words are compound words that are made up of two or more words, usually with hyphens between them. In simple words, hyphens are used between words to form hyphenated words. Hyphens are used in some compound words. Examples are President Select, Self-Help, Anti-War. The rules for using hyphens are always changing. So, students, it is always better to check with a good dictionary before using a hyphen. Once a particular spelling is chosen, it must be used consistently. Here, consistently means regularly. So, once a particular spelling is chosen, it must be used consistently means regularly. Students, now let's see when to use M dash with examples. The M dash is otherwise called as long dash, is different from N dash and hyphen. Twice as long as the N dash, the long dash can be used in place of a comma, parenthesis or colon to enhance readability or emphasize the conclusion of a sentence. Now, let's see the first usage. The M dash is used to show a break in a sentence. Example sentences are, we could not wait to meet them. We had missed them so much. Please call my supervisor, John Wick, on Friday. Now let's see the second usage. The M dash is used for marking off unimportant words. For example, to get to New York from here, you are heading there, right? You need a car or a train. Third one is, the long dash is used to create emphasis. Here, emphasis means special importance. So, the long dash is used to create emphasis means special importance. Example sentences like, I need to go to the supermarket to buy three things, toothpaste, shampoo and soap. My mom loves fish. My dad loves chicken. Next, we are going to learn about the N dash. The N dash takes the same space as the printed letter N. Now let's see when to use N dash with examples. The N dash is slightly wider than the hyphen but narrower than the M dash. It is used in writing or printing to indicate a range or connections. Now let's see the usage. The first usage is, the N dash expresses a period of time. Now let's see some example sentences. He lived in this town from 1998 to 2009. The bus journey takes 20 to 30 minutes. Quotation marks are used in two main ways. Students, here we can see double quotation marks and single quotation marks. First, let's see the usage. The first usage is to enclose the title of a published work like a book, film, play, newspaper, etc. We use single or double quotation marks for titles of published works. Example sentences. The Daffodils was written by William Wordsworth. We use italics instead of quotation marks for titles of published works. If we are typing it out, example sentences. I read Good Morning India every morning. Next, let's see the second usage. To enclose the exact words that someone else has written or said. Now let's see the example sentence. Justin is going to the cinema hall, said mother. First, we are going to see what is parts of speech. Words are divided according to their positions and usages in a sentence. This is called parts of speech. So what is parts of speech? Words are divided according to their positions and usages in a sentence. This is called parts of speech. Usually, parts of speech tell us how a word is used in a sentence. In other words, words are divided into different kinds or classes. called parts of speech according to their use, that is, according to the work they do in a sentence. The parts of speech are 8 in number. So, there are 8 parts of speech in the English language: noun, verb, adjective, conjunction, preposition, interjection, pronoun, and adverb. Next, we are going to learn about types of nouns. The name of a person, place, or thing is called a noun, or the noun is a naming word. Examples: Milton, England, book, song, player, etc. There are several different types of nouns as follows: common noun, proper noun, concrete noun, abstract noun, collective nouns. Next, we are going to learn about types of adjectives. The first type is qualitative or descriptive adjectives, quantitative adjectives, demonstrative adjectives. Fourth type is interrogative adjectives. Fifth one is possessive adjectives. Sixth one is distributive adjectives. Seventh type is proper adjectives. Eighth one is numeral adjectives. And ninth one is emphasizing adjectives. Next, we are going to learn about what is a pronoun and types of pronouns. Pronouns are used in place of nouns. The purpose of pronouns is to avoid repetition and make sentences easier to understand. Some of the most common pronouns are he, she, it, they, and this. Next, let's see types of pronouns. The first type is the personal pronoun, the demonstrative pronoun, the interrogative pronoun, the relative pronoun, the indefinite pronoun, the reflexive pronoun, and the intensive pronoun. Now let's see.
In order to make a meaningful and proper sentence in English, you should know very well about the tenses. Tenses play a crucial role in the English language. It denotes the time an action takes place, whether sometime in the past, in the present, or will take some time in the future. So we have three basic tenses in English, like present tense, past tense, and future tense. We are classifying these tenses in the basis of 4 aspects, like simple, continuous, perfect, and perfect continuous. By classifying the tenses on the basis of 4 aspects, we get 12 types of tenses in English, like simple present tense, simple past tense, simple future tense, present continuous tense, which is also known as present progressive tense, past continuous tense, future continuous tense, present perfect tense, past perfect tense, future perfect tense, present perfect continuous tense, past perfect continuous tense, and future perfect continuous tense. Now, let's begin with simple present tense. The structure of simple present tense is subject plus V1 form of your verb. Your V1 form of your verb means, for if your subject is going to be he, she, it, you should use V1 plus yes form. If your subject is going to be I, we, you, they, you should use only V1 form. So where do we use simple present tense? We use it in the cases of habits and routines, facts, and proverbs. So whenever you're going to represent your habitual actions and routines, Like, for example, I drink coffee every morning. He plays cricket regularly. So these two actions are happening regularly and every morning. So you use simple present tense here. In the first case, your subject is I. So your verb form should be just be1, that is drink. And in your second case, your subject is he. As I said earlier, for he, she, it, you should use subject plus be1 plus yes form. So you are using be1 plus yes form, that is play plus yes gives place here. The second case, for universal facts or universal truth also, you should go with simple present tense. For example, the sun rises in the east. Water boils at 100 degrees Celsius. These two cases are universal facts or truth which you can never change. So you should use simple present tense here. The third case is proverbs. All proverbs only occur with simple present tense. For example, the pen is mightier than the sword. Practice makes perfect. Prevention is better than cure. So these are all the places where you should use simple present tense, and we have some keywords to identify simple present tense. For example, always, often, regularly, usually, generally, never, sometimes, every day. These are the keywords of simple present tense. The next type of tense is simple past tense. The structure of simple past tense is be2 form of the verb. It denotes past action. That is, whenever you are going to represent some action that has got completed already, you have to use simple past tense. For example, we went to Mumbai last week. The be1 form of the verb here is go. So the be2 form of go is went. So we went to Mumbai last week. She cooked the fried rice yesterday. V2 form here is cook and V1 form here is cook. You played the match last month. The V2 form of the verb here, that is the past form here, is played, and V1 form is play. So whenever you're getting words like keywords like last week, yesterday, last month, once, ago, all these things represent the action that has got completed in the past. So you have to use simple past tense in that case. The next type of tense is simple future tense. The structure of simple future tense is will or shall plus be1 form of the verb. You use shall in the place of I and we, and you use will in the place of he, she, it, they. So based on your subject, will and shall gets interchanged. The simple future tense is a verb tense that expresses actions or states in the future. The future tense is used to state some action that is going to happen or will or shall happen later on. For example, I shall do my homework in future. So this is the future tense. You are using the format of shall plus be1 form of the verb. You are using shall because your subject is I here. As I said earlier, if your subject is going to be I and we, you have to use shall plus be1 form of the verb. The next example is he will bring the book tomorrow. Your subject is he here, so you have to use will plus be1 form of the verb. Next sentence is she will go to school early in future. Your subject is she here, so you're using will plus be1 form of the verb. So whenever your sentence is indicating a future action, you can go with simple future tense. The keywords for simple future tense are tomorrow, next week, in future, soon, shortly. Dear students, we began with the topic tenses in your last class. We have already covered three basic tenses in English, and now in this video, let us see about the continuous tense. Continuous tense is also known as progressive tense. So we have three continuous tenses in English, like present continuous tense, past continuous tense, and future continuous tense. Let us begin with the structure of present continuous tense now. The structure of present continuous tense is am or is or are plus verb plus ing. So based on your subject, the be form verb or the structure of the tense differs. For example, if your subject is going to be I, your structure will be am plus verb plus ing. If your subject is he or she or it, your structure will be is plus verb plus ing. If your subject is be or you or they, your structure will be or plus verb plus ing. For example, let us take the verb listen. How will you convert listen for all these subjects in your present continuous tense? If your subject is I, your sentence will be I am listening now. He is listening now. She is listening now. It is listening now. We are listening now. You are listening now. They are listening now. So based on your subject, your structure of the tense get differed. Where do you use present continuous tense? We use present continuous tense in two cases. The first one is whenever you're going to represent some action that is happening at that moment. For example, John is drinking coffee right now. So John is a boy. He is drinking coffee at that moment. The action of drinking coffee is happening at that moment. So you use present continuous tense is drinking. The same way, they are playing tennis at present. The dog is jumping here and there now. The second case we are going to use present continuous tense is actions in near future. That is, the actions happening in future and they are planned correctly. For example, we are going for a picnic tomorrow. Peter is flying to London tomorrow. So these are happening in future. Though they are happening in future, they are some planned actions. So we use future tense there. The keywords for future tense are now, at present, at the moment, while. The next tense we are going to see now is past continuous tense. The structure of past continuous tense is subject plus was or were plus verb plus ing. When your subject is I or he or she or it, you have to use was plus verb plus ing. If your subject is going to be you or we or they, you have to use were plus verb plus ing. When your sentence consists of some unfinished or ongoing action in the past which is followed by some finished action, you use past continuous tense in that case. For example, I was having dinner with my family when the doorbell rang. So you have two incidents happening here, that is the ringing of the doorbell and having dinner. So having dinner started in the past and it was happening, and by the time the incident happened is ringing of the doorbell. So the finished action here is ringing of the doorbell and the unfinished action or the progressive action is having dinner. So we use past continuous for the incident having dinner. The next sentence is he was fighting with the boy when the teacher came in. The power went out while the children were studying. Keywords for past continuous tense are then, when, and while. The next tense we are going to see here is future continuous tense. The structure of future continuous tense is subject plus will or shall plus be plus verb plus ing. So based on your subject, you have to decide whether you're going to use will or shall. If your subject is going to be I or we, you should use shall plus be plus verb plus ing. And if your subject is going to be he, she, it, they and you, you have to use will plus be plus verb plus ing. So where do we use future continuous tense? We use future continuous tense in the place of some actions that are ongoing actions in the future. The actions that are starting to take part in the future and going to progress in the future, we use future continuous tense. For example, they will be playing cricket tomorrow this time. From this sentence, you come to know they are going to start to play cricket tomorrow and it is going to progress for a particular time tomorrow in the same time. So we are using future continuous tense in that case. He will be reading novel next Sunday this time. So how can you identify future continuous tense easily is by using the keywords like tomorrow this time, next month this time, next year this time. Dear students, already we have covered simple tenses and continuous tenses in your previous videos. Now let's begin with perfect tenses. First, let us see about present perfect tense in detail. So the structure of present perfect tenses, subject plus have or has plus V3. What is V3? V3 is nothing but your past participle form of the verb. Let us take an example verb called eat. E-A-T, eat. So eat is your V1 form of the verb. What is the V2 form of eat? Ate. What is the V3 form of eat? Eaten. So eat, ate, eaten. Likewise, let us take the verb called see. What is the past form of see? Saw. Saw. What is the past participle form of see? Seen. Seen. See, saw, seen, eat, ate, eaten. So now let us vary the subject. For I, you, we, they, you use have plus V3 form, that is your structure. And for he, she, it as subjects, you have to use has plus V3 form. So this is the structure of present perfect tense. Where do we use present perfect tense? We use present perfect tense in the case of describing about our experience. For example, I have taught English to many students. In this sentence, we are explaining the experience of teaching English. Since your subject is I, you have to use have plus V3. That is, the V1 form of the verb is teach, V3 form of teach is taught. So I have taught English to many students. Second sentence is Kevin has visited France 4 times. The subject you use for Kevin is he. So when you use he, you have to use has plus V3 form. The base form of verb is visit. So when you convert visit into V3 form, visited. So Kevin has visited France 4 times. The second case you are going to use present perfect tense is for the actions completed just now. That is recently completed actions. For example, I have just finished my homework. The word just indicates the action has happened recently. Since your subject is I, you have to use have plus V3, that is have finished. The second sentence is she recently has gone to Delhi. She is your subject, so you have to use has plus V3 form. Go, went, gone. So gone is the V3 form of go. Since the action is happening recently, you are using has gone. So the keywords for present perfect tense are already, just now, it, never, ever, before, earlier, till now, and recently. The next type of tense is past perfect tense. The structure of past perfect tense is subject plus had plus V3 form of your verb. So where do we use past perfect tense? If your sentence consists of 2 past action, you have to indicate the first past action in past perfect tense and the second action in just past tense. That is your simple past tense. For example, when we reached the station, the train had left. So the first past action happening here is leaving of the train. So you have to indicate it in past perfect tense, that is had plus V3, had left. The second sentence, before Leela returned home, the parrot had flown away. So the first past action happening here is flying of the parrot. So you have to indicate in past perfect tense, had plus V3 form. That is fly, flew, flown. So you have to write had flown. Had plus V3, had flown. I was sick because I had eaten too much the previous night. So the first action happening here is eating too much. Only after eating too much, he was getting sick. So you have to write it as had plus V3 form, that is had eaten. Eat, ate, eaten. The last sentence is before teacher entered the classroom, the bell had rung. So the first action happening here is ringing of the bell. So ring, rang, rung. Had plus V3, had rung. So the keywords for past perfect tense are till, before, after, since, already, when. The next type of tense is future perfect tense. The structure of future perfect tense is subject plus will or shall plus have plus V3. As we all know, we have to use will in the place of he, she, it, they, you. And we use shall in the place of I and we. Where do we use future perfect tense? actions that will be done in a short span of time. So whenever you're representing some particular point of time or some short span of time, when will the action get completed, you have to use future perfect tense. For example, by the end of March, Kathy will have learnt all the lessons in our books. So they are representing a particular time, that is end of March. By the end of March, Kathy should have completed. She will have learnt all the lessons in our books. That is will plus have plus V3, learn, learnt, learnt. The next sentence, by August, Jahana will have saved rupees 1 lakh. So by the month of August, Jahana, she will have saved, will have saved, will plus have plus V3. Save, saved, saved. By next year, we shall have paid the home loan. So, shall plus have plus V3. Pay, paid, paid. The keywords for future perfect tense are by next month, by next year, by this weekend. Dear students, already we have seen simple tenses, continuous tenses and perfect tenses in your previous videos. And now, in this video, we shall see about perfect continuous tenses. Now let's begin with present perfect continuous tense first. The structure of present perfect continuous tenses: subject plus have or has been plus verb plus ing. For all perfect continuous tenses, been plus verb plus ing is common. So you know where to use have and has, as we have already seen in the previous videos. So what is present perfect continuous tense? Where do we use present perfect continuous tense? Actions that started in the past and still continuing. So you use this for some actions which has already started in the past and still in progress. For example, we have been living in this house for 10 years. It means you started to live in this house before 10 years and even now still you are living in this house. So we have to use present perfect continuous tense, that is have plus been plus verb plus ing. Since your subject is we, you have to use have been living. The second sentence is, I have been studying in the school since 2010. So from the year of 2010, I have been studying in the school. I started studying in the year of 2010 and still now I am studying here. They have been waiting to see the doctor for 2 hours. So before 2 hours, I arrived to the hospital and still now I am waiting to see the doctor. Isaac has been learning English since last October. Since the subject you use for Isaac is he, you have to use has plus been plus verb plus ing, that is learning. The keywords you use for present perfect continuous tense are since, for, ever since. For example, you use since in the place of whenever you have to indicate some year or months, and you use for in the place of whenever you have to indicate some duration or period of time. The next type of tense is past perfect continuous tense. The structure of past perfect continuous tense is subject plus had been plus verb plus ing. So where do we use past perfect continuous tense? This is the same as past perfect tense. In past perfect tense also you have two past actions. The first action you will represent in past perfect tense and the second action you will represent in past tense. We are following the same rules here. The first action you have to represent in past perfect continuous tense and the second action you have to represent in past perfect tense. Okay, for example, I had been waiting for a long time before my bus came. For I, you have to use had plus been plus verb plus ing, that is had been waiting for a long time before my bus came. So the first action that has happened here is waiting for the bus, and only then the bus has arrived. The second sentence is, I felt really tired because I have been driving since morning. So since morning I have been driving, that is why I felt tired. So the first action is driving, okay, that is since morning I have been driving. So the second action is feeling tired. You are indicating the first action in past perfect continuous tense and the second action in past tense. Next example, she had been waiting for 2 hours when the doctors finally arrived. The ground was wet because it had been raining. So the first action is raining. Only because of raining, the ground has got wet. So you are using past perfect continuous tense for the first action, and for the second one you are using past tense. So the keywords are since, ever since, and for. The most common keywords for perfect continuous tenses, that is for all perfect continuous tenses, is since, ever, ever since, and for. The last type of tense is future perfect continuous tense. It is also known as rare tense in English because we don't use it mostly. The structure of future perfect continuous tenses: subject plus will or shall have been plus verb plus ing. Where do we use future perfect continuous tense? Action that started in the past, continued in the present, and extended to future. So some action that has already started in the past and continuing at present and even extending in the future also. And it should indicate the point of time. For example, by 5 p.m. we shall have been painting the living room for 10 hours. It means the action is painting the living room. That action has already started in the past and happening in the present and even going to happen in the future, and they are indicating the time that it will be 10 hours by 5 p.m. That is the time they are indicating that. That is, by 5 p.m. we shall have been painting the living room for 10 hours. The next is, by next December, Sheila will have been living in this house for 10 years. So Sheila has already started to live in the house and she is living now, and she will also be living in the future, and the time they are indicating there is by next December Sheila will have been living in this house for 10 years. So the keywords for your future perfect continuous tense are ever, since, and for. So I've given you example for all 12 tenses here. I'm considering V1 verb drink here. So drink is the verb that I considered. What I'm doing is, using the verb called drink, I am framing sentences in all 12 tenses.
Now let's see what is meant by note making. Note making is a way of recording important details from a source. This source can be any book, article, meeting, or any oral discussion. In note making, the writer records the essence of the information. It helps us to understand and clarify thinking. Note making saves a lot of time by going through the notes made. One can get a glimpse of a lot of information from a short note. Next, we are going to see the procedure of note making. First, read the passage provided. Then underline the important sentences. It helps to make headings and subheadings. Then make a rough note first so as to get an idea. Next, organize them in logical order or sequence for the final note. Then use the appropriate note making format. Then do not change the idea or the message of the passage. Next, we are going to see note making format. There is a fixed note making format. One needs to follow this note making format in order to have a clear and unambiguous understanding from it. Here, unambiguous means clear or explicit understanding from it. The note making format as heading. It shows the title or the heading of note. Next, subheading. As the name suggests, a subheading is a subdivision of the main topic. One can use as many subheadings as he or she wants. Next, we have point. Below subheading, there are some points which are the part of the main topics. Then we have subheading. One can add more headings below the points for showing the category, types, advantages, etc. Then we have key or keywords. The key portion of the note shows the various codes, symbols, or the abbreviation used. It helps to get a clear understanding of the keys used in the note-making format. After key or keywords, which means after completing key to abbreviations, write the word summary and give the same title to it as the main passage. Then use points, that is notes, to write the summary. Next, we are going to see note making format. Students, this is your note making format. First, you have to write heading or title. Under this, we have first subheading. Under first subheading, you have to write 2 points. Then we have second subheading. Under second subheading, you have to write 2 points. Under 2 points, you have to write 2 subpoints. Then we have third subheading. Under third subheading, you have to write 2 points. Next, we are going to see how to write note making. Follow the following steps. Step number 1, read the passage carefully. Then try to get the theme and subject of the passage. You may ask yourself, what is this passage about? This will provide you the gist. Step number 2, read carefully, identify main ideas and important supporting details. Step number 3, make notes of the main ideas, underheadings and add subpoints under subheadings. Step number 4, use proper format. Finally, step number 5, use recognizable abbreviations wherever possible. Next, we are going to see an example of note making. Now, let's read the passage. There are many different kinds of musical instruments. They are divided into 3 main classes according to the way they are played. For example, some instruments are played by blowing air into them. These are called wind instruments. In some of these, the air is made to vibrate inside a wooden tube, and these are said to be of the woodwind family. The examples of this family are the flute, the clarinet and the bassoon. Other instruments are made of brass. The trumpet and the horn are the examples. There are also various other wind instruments such as the mouth organ and the bagpipes. Some instruments are played by banging or striking them. One obvious example is the drum, of which there are various kinds. Instruments like this are called percussion instruments. The last big group of instruments are the ones which have strings. There are 2 main kinds of stringed instruments: those in which the music is made by plucking the strings, and those where the player draws a bow across the strings. Examples of the former are the harp and the guitar, and that of the latter are the violin and the cello. Students, here is a sample note making for you. I have given the title as musical instruments. Below that, I have written the word notes. In the first paragraph, I have written the subheading is kinds of musical instruments, and below that I have written 3 points like wind, inst dot flute, then percussion, inst dot, then stringed instruments. Here I have used abbreviation like inst dot, that is for instruments. Then under 3 points I have written 2 subpoints like made by plucking the strings. Next subpoint is that the player draws a bow across the strings. In the second paragraph also I have written the subheading is how to play it, and below that I have written 2 points like by blowing air, then by banging or striking. Here another important thing that you have to remember is indenting. Indenting is nothing but giving numbers to your subheadings and your points. Both should never fall in one line. Students, look at the points I have given for the subheadings. They are slightly inside compared to the subheading. So, students, this is very important. Remember, this is how your notes should look. Once you have completed writing the notes for all the paragraphs, below that you have to write the key to abbreviations. Here I have used only one abbreviation like inst dot for instruments. After completing key to abbreviations, you have to write summary. Next, we are going to learn about what is error spotting. Error spotting is part of verbal ability section in which grammatically incorrect sentences are spotted or corrected. So, error spotting is part of verbal ability section in which grammatically incorrect, which means grammatically wrong, sentences are spotted or corrected. It can be noun, pronoun, singular, plural, adjective, article, anything. Next, we are going to see rules for spotting errors. First, let's see subject-verb agreement. So, the rule is two or more singular subjects connected by and usually take a verb in the plural. For example, Hari and Ram is here. It is incorrect sentence, whereas Hari and Ram are here, it is correct sentence. Why? Because the rule is two or more singular subjects connected by and usually take a verb in the plural. So in this sentence, Hari and Ram are two singular subjects connected by and. So usually we have to put a verb in the plural form. So, what is the plural verb here? Yes, or is the plural verb here. So, Hari and Ram are here. It is the correct sentence. Now, look at the first sentence. He have two sisters. Is that correct sentence? No. The correct sentence is he has two sisters. The rule is that if the subject is I, you, we, they, or any other plural noun, then we use the verb in its present tense form and we don't add s to the verb. But if the subject is he, she, it, or any singular noun, then we add s to the verb. Here, he has two sisters is the correct sentence. Let's see next rule. If two singular nouns refer to the same person or thing. The verb must be singular. Let me read it again. If two singular nouns refer to the same person or thing, the verb must be singular. First, look at the sentence. The secretary and principal are coming. Is that correct sentence? No. The correct sentence is the secretary and principal is coming. Why? Because here the same person is secretary as well as principal. Here the secretary and principal are two singular nouns refer to the same person. So we use the verb must be singular, that is. So the correct sentence is the secretary and principal is coming. Then move on to the next rule. If the singular subjects are preceded by each or every, the verb is usually singular. Now look at the first sentence. Every boy and girl were ready. Is that correct sentence? No. The correct sentence is every boy and girl was ready. Why? Because the rule is if the singular subjects are preceded, here preceded means come before by each or every, the verb is usually singular. Here boy and girl are two singular subjects, are come before by every, so we have to add the singular verb was to it. So the correct sentence is every boy and girl was ready. Let's see next rule. Two or more singular subjects connected by are nor either or neither nor, take a verb in the singular. First, look at the sentence. Neither he nor I were there. Is that correct sentence? No. The correct sentence is neither he nor I was there. Here he and I are two singular subjects connected by neither nor. So we have to add a singular verb was to it. So the correct sentence is neither he nor I was there. Next rule is that when the subjects joined by are nor are of different numbers, the verb must be plural and the plural subject must be placed next to the verb. Now look at the example. Neither the assistant masters nor the headmaster was present. Is that correct sentence? No. The correct sentence is neither the headmaster nor the assistant masters were present. Why? Because in the second sentence, the master and the assistant masters are two subjects joined by nor. So the verb must be plural and the plural subject must be placed next to the verb. So the correct sentence is neither the headmaster nor the assistant masters were present. Now let's see the rule. Some nouns always use a singular verb. Example, advice, scenery, stationery, mathematics, news. The first sentence is that mathematics are a difficult subject. Is that correct? No. The correct sentence is mathematics is a difficult subject. Some nouns end in s, but they are always singular. For example, news, physics, politics, mathematics, etc. Let's see the next rule. Certain nouns, being a singular form, represent plurality and therefore Take a plural verb in a sentence. Let me read it again. Certain nouns, being a singular form, represent plurality and therefore take a plural verb in a sentence. Example, police, clergy, people, cattle. Let's see the first sentence. People has left. Is that correct sentence? No. The correct sentence is people have left. Some nouns have a singular form but they are used in plural sense, like police, cattle, clergy, people, etc. Next, we are going to see wrong usage of verbs. The rule is, when there are two subjects in a sentence and there are not in the same number, then we must have to use separate auxiliaries like is, are, am, was, were, have, as for both of them. Let me read it again. When there are two subjects in a sentence and they are not in the same number, then we must have to use separate auxiliaries is, are, am, was, were, have, as for both of them. Let's see the first sentence. Three killed and one were injured. Is that correct sentence? No. The correct sentence is three were killed and one was injured. Why? Because three and one are two subjects in a sentence and they are not in the same number. So, we must have to use separate auxiliaries for both of them. Like, three were killed and one was injured. Next, we are going to see wrong usage of adjectives. Adjectives of quantity show how much of a thing is meant. Adjectives of quantity, some, much, little, enough, all, no, any, great, of, sufficient, whole, are used for uncountable nouns only. Here, rice is the uncountable noun, right? So, we use adjective some to it. Next rule is that when the pronoun one is used, it should be maintained throughout the whole sentence. Let's see the first sentence. One must help his siblings. Is that correct sentence? No. The correct sentence is one must help one's siblings. Next rule is that for living people, whose is generally used, and for things that are non-living, which is used. Let's see the first sentence. Which phone is kept on charging? Is that correct sentence? No. The correct sentence is whose phone is kept on charging? Certain nouns take the plural verb because of their plural form. Example, cloths, scissors, trousers, amends, spectacles, thanks. Let's see the first sentence. The spectacles is missing. Is that correct sentence? No. The correct sentence is the spectacles are missing. Some nouns are always used in plural. For example, trousers, scissors, savings, innings, spectacles, quarters, etc. Now, let's see what is letter writing. Letter writing is an important channel of communication between two people who are geographically distant from one another. Here, channel means medium. So, letter writing is an important medium of communication between two people who are geographically distant from one another. In the earlier times, when the telephone and email were not available, right? So the only means of communication between people was through letters. Letter writing is a skill that has to be developed. In general, there are two types of letters. The first one is formal letters and the second one is informal letters. Formal letters are written to convey official business information, and informal letters, which are personal letters to communicate with friends and family. A letter is usually one in a series of exchanges between two people. Let's see definition of formal letter and informal letter. A formal letter is a letter written to a business, a college, or any professional that are not considered friends or family. An informal letter is a letter you would write to a friend or family. Next, we are going to see letter writing format of informal letters. First, address, date, salutation, body of the letter, sender's name and signature. The first one is address. The sender's address is important in informal letters since informal letters are personal letters and sent to acquaintances. So what is mean by an acquaintance? An acquaintance is someone who you have met and know slightly but not well, or people who are known. The receiver's address is only mentioned on the envelope carrying the letter. Next, date. Immediately after the sender's address comes the date on which the letter is written. Candidates, while writing the letter in the exam, can follow any of the formats to write the dates. First one is DD/MM/YY. Here, DD refers date, MM refers month, YY refers year, or MM/DD/YY. Third one is salutation. Salutation in informal letters can be dear or dearest, hi or hello, followed by the first name or nickname of the recipient, which means receiver. Fourth one is body of the letter. The body in the informal letters can be long and detailed, containing diverse feelings, experiences, advice, news, etc. Fifth one is sender's name and signature. This is the last part where the sender of the letter signs off with his first or last name. The signature line may also include a second line for the title or designation of the sender. Now, we are going to see an example of informal letter. This is an example of informal letter. Write a letter to your friend describing your school day function. 7. North Street, Anna Nagar West, Chennai, 2nd November 2020. Dear Nitya, well and hope so. Last Friday, we had our school day function It was nice and wonderful. We had interesting cultural programs also. I took part in the English drama, Hamlet. Prizes were distributed and I enjoyed the whole day. Expecting your reply. Yours affectionately, V. Ramya. Address on the envelope. To V. Nitya, South Street, Netaji Nagar, Trichy. Now, look at the format of letters, formal letter as well as informal letter. Formal letter, we have from address to address, salutation, subject, introduction, body of the letter, conclusion, subscription, place, date, address on the envelope. In that, we have to write to address. Informal letter, from address, date, salutation, introduction, body of the letter, conclusion, subscription, address on the envelope. In that, you have to write to address. Now, let's see what is a figure of speech, a word or phrase used in a non-literal sense so that the speech or writing becomes more persuasive, vivid and relatable. Here, persuasive means believable, vivid means bright, relatable means related or important. So, what is a figure of speech? A word or phrase used in a non-literal sense so that the speech or writing becomes more believable, bright and relatable, which means related or important. Alliteration. First, we have to know what is mean by alliteration. Alliteration is the repetition of initial consonant sounds of neighboring words. In other words, alliteration is the repetition of beginning consonant sounds. Let's identify the alliteration in the poem A Poison Tree. I was angry with my foe, night and morning, with my tears, and I sunned it with smiles, till it bore an apple bright. So, the alliterated words are was, with, morning, my, sunned, smiles, bore, bright. Now, let's see the rhyming words. What is mean by rhyming words? Rhyming words are two or more words that have the same or similar ending sound. Some examples of rhyming words are goat, boat, coat. Let's read this stanza. I was angry with my friend. I told my wrath. My wrath did end. I was angry with my foe. I told it not. My wrath did grow. Question number 1. Pick out the rhyming words. So the rhyming words are friend, end, foe, grow. Question number 2. What is the rhyme scheme of the stanza? So the answer is AABB. Students, prepare well for your exams. So now, we have reached the end of this session. Thank you.